Good morning. Thank you, Joy. What a gift and what a blessing to welcome you this morning as we come to Wells to worship together, to seek the God who is already seeking us and seeking to live in relationship with us. What a joy it is to be able to share our time with you this morning. We are so grateful that you've joined us, and we don't take that for granted. Please continue to do so and invite others to do so. I remind you, for those who don't do Facebook, we are live on our website as well, so you can join us there as long as you have internet and join us as we worship together each week at 10:30. Well, we continue to move forward in this pandemic. We continue to monitor executive orders and the things that are going on around us, the numbers that continue to, at this point, begin to take a bit of a downward turn, and we're grateful for that. But we continue to pray for that. Thanks to those who filled out the survey and took the time to submit that for us. It's going to be helpful for us as we journey forward into when to know when to come back into in-person worship and how to go about doing that. Well, our church council will meet by Zoom today at 11:30. For those who are on our church council, remember to join us in that. Also, I just remind you that at the end of the service, we'll have a time where we close out remembering God's gracious and loving presence that is always with us through communion. And so if you want to participate in that, I invite you to get what's necessary, the bread and juice that will join us in that. I also invite you to join me this week, weather permitting. I know that there is a tropical storm named Sally. All of my relatives on the coast are singing Lay Down Sally this morning for some reason. And so I think it's an appropriate song to enter into this week with. But we will, if it is raining and the forecast is not good, we will postpone and I will set another time to join him. But I'll be in Clinton on Monday, weather permitting. On Tuesday in Flowood, and on Thursday at Jamie Fowler Boyle Park here in Jackson. So join me as we share together in conversation and communion. I appreciate so much last week the two chances we had here at Wells and in Madison at Strawberry Patch Park. It went so incredibly well. It was great to see some of you as you joined me there. So others plan to join me in Clinton and Flowood and in at Jamie Fowler Boyle Park this week. Again, if the weather does not permit on those evenings at 5:30, we will reschedule. But watch the weather and join me if it's going to be okay. Also, I'll remind you of our Zoom meetings, Coffee with Chris, 6:30 a.m. on Tuesday mornings, and also our prayer meeting on Wednesday evening at 7. Please stay tuned to our resources, our websites, our emails, for more updated information about when and how we may join together and have times of being able to worship and commune again together real soon. And so we look forward to that time. Thank you for being here. As we do here at Wells, we celebrate God's goodness. We celebrate milestones in people's lives. We celebrate what God is doing in our midst. And so we lift up birthdays and anniversaries, anniversaries of sobriety dates. And so today, if you haven't one of those, I've got a pretty good long list of birthdays today that I'm going to share. But if I don't call your name, please let us know that you're having a birthday this week so we can celebrate that with you, or an anniversary of a sobriety date. So I do know this week that Reginald Nichols, Gail Spencer, Lindsay Smith, Teresa Parker, Brenda Donald, Ken Farmer, David Hampton has a birthday soon. Nancy Halfacre, Michael Allen, Tiffany Bobbs, Tracy Furness, Lynn Taylor, Lucy Hansford, Anna Everly, Jana McNair, and Alinda Ponder all celebrate birthdays this coming week, either from today until next Sunday. So give them a shout out. Tell them happy birthday as we share together. Also, I do know that this week there is one anniversary. Sean and Annie Ryer Carter are celebrating an anniversary. This one will be a little different with a new child. Theo will be with them to celebrate this year, and we're so grateful for that. So blessings and peace and grace as you continue your journey and as God continues to bless you. As you celebrate another year of birth or of life after birth, or as you celebrate another year of being married together. May God be with you. I am so glad that you've chosen to join us here today as we worship together. I invite you to continue to worship with me as we stand where we are and affirm our faith together, and we share those things that we can believe in and that we do believe in as we share this statement of faith of the United Church of Canada together today. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Well, may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and may you share those signs of love and peace who are there with you in the room, and be sure to share peace with someone along your way this day. We're so grateful that you are here.
suffers pain, and your health you can't regain, and your soul is slowly sinking in despair. Jesus knows the pain you feel. He can save and He can heal. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Leave it there. Leave it there. Just take your burden to the Lord.
Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. We share our prayer concerns and needs with one another. And again, today I have a pretty good list I want to share, but there are others I think you'll want us to be in prayer for. And I invite you, if you're on Facebook Live, to type those in so that we can share those with you and that we can be praying with you this week as we share these. And so today I want us to continue to pray for our families who've lost loved ones over these past few months. We've had several here in the church and in the life of our church who've lost loved ones, and we continue to lift them in prayer and pray for God's strength and presence and peace in their lives. Well, we pray also for those dealing with wildfires in Oregon and Washington and California. Kathy Maloney, who's now in North Carolina, ask us to remember a friend, Juanita, in Oregon, who had to evacuate from one of the wildfires. We also continue to pray for those recovering from Hurricane Laura. That still is a very, very much a need, and we continue to pray for those who are recovering there. We pray for those preparing for a tropical storm, which we think will become Hurricane Sally, and for those in that path. We continue to pray for Kathy, Jamie's friend, and for Mary Hurd, for Keith and Glenda Ferguson, for Keith and Brenda Ferguson's parents, for Natalie Long, for Christine Norquist, for Carrie Bizzle, who lost his wife Diane to cancer this week, friend of David Hampton, for Joe Orr and her husband Ben, for Joey Brazier and Mom Estelle, for Joni Strahan, for Joel Gray, for Martha Odom, for Pam Spell, for David Moody, for Bill Morrow, for Elizabeth Harrison, for Jean Boykin, for Courtney and Katie Donald, for Trina and Bruce Reynolds. We continue to pray for those affected by coronavirus and those who are responding to it. We continue to pray for our nation, for our state, for our world, for God's presence to be near. For we pray that somehow in the midst of this election season that we will hold down our divisiveness and polarization, and that somehow we'll find a way to move forward unifying this country and unifying with each other. And as Christians, I remind you to please do your part to not cause further polarization. Be careful on social media and other things as you share those. Continue to pray for God's guidance. Continue to pray that God will lead us. Well, I invite you to continue to lift the concerns that people are typing in even now as we share in this moment of silence together, and then I will lead us as we pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, this year has been one of burdens. One that our lives have been changed. Our lives have been challenged. In the midst of the COVID pandemic, in the midst of storms and wildfires, in the midst of struggling ourselves with knowing how and when to move forward with worship, we know that you are there with us. And even when we can't see you, we know that you are working for our good and that you walk with us each step of our way. God, you never promised us that things would be easy. You've never promised us that everything was going to be a cakewalk or that we would be constantly positive all of our lives. But you have promised that no matter what we face, that you are there with us. God, we call on that this day because we know that you will see us through. Oh God, there's so much on our hearts that have come from our lips and have come from deep within that we offer to you with sighs too deep for words. And we pray that you hear our cry. And oh Lord, you will lift down your healing hand and touch those who need healing. That you will lift down your arms of love and grace and surround us, and especially those who need to know there's hope. And that you, oh God, will offer peace. Help us never to give up hope, O God, but to know that you walk with us, even through the midst of the storms and burdens of our lives. Be here and journey with us. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the one who taught us to pray as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen.
a shining road that leaves me on the life for you's worth losing you forever.
Life wasn't always ending up this way, but heaven's love at stake and hell to pay. You and God's loving plan might be the missing part.
You must live so I give you to His heart.
Wish that life wasn't always ending up this way, with heaven's love at stake and hell to pay. But you and God's loving plan might be the missing part.
Give it up for Joy and the boys. That's what I've deemed them as today. What a blessing. Joy Gates, we're so glad you're here and have joined us for that. Wilson, good to have you back. And Ken, have you around occasionally. And David, we're always glad to have you with us. Thank you for sharing that with us. What a blessing. And what a blessing to have you with us today. Well, we're continuing on this complicated story of a people of faith. And for those who've been keeping track, I suggested that we do Exodus 3 today, but there's just too much I had to skip over in Exodus chapter 2. So please allow me to divert and take a step back and look at Exodus chapter 2 today. We'll read verses 1 through 10, but as you know, it'll be a filling in of story throughout the whole chapter. So I invite you to take your Bibles if you have them there where you are, and boy, I hadn't said that in a while, or your iPads where it may be located, and join me as we share together this reading from Exodus chapter 2. Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrews' children," she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses because she said, I drew him out of the water. Well, may God add blessing to the reading, hearing, understanding, and living out of His Word. Well, in this complicated story of a people of faith, we've journeyed with patriarchs and matriarchs, and we've seen how the blessing and the covenant of God that was originated with Abraham passed down through Abraham's generation after generation. We left it in the end of Genesis with Jacob's children, specifically Joseph, who was the one that was raised up and was to become someone who would help Pharaoh and become the chief steward for Pharaoh during a time of famine. We also saw that that beloved family came and shared with them. And so they moved to Egypt because of the famine and because they were welcomed and because there was plenty for them there. And so they went there. But as we talked about last week, as we began the book of Exodus, that group grew to be large. It's interesting now that we've made a transition from the blessing and the covenant being linked with a particular heir in a family to now it's the whole people of God who are in covenant with God. The people known as Israelites because they were Israel's, Jacob's children. Jacob having a new name under experience with God. And so we know them as the Israelites now are the ones who have the blessing and who are called to live into the covenant. But as they're in Egypt living out the time of the famine, there arose a Pharaoh who did not know Joseph. And so they became seen as a threat because there were so many of them. And we saw last week that Pharaoh, having in his fear being threatened, decided to force hard labor on the Israelites. And he put taskmasters over them that held them accountable to the task and continued to put out just jobs that were not attainable for them to do. And then when that didn't work to slow down the population of Israelites, then Pharaoh put out a mandate that all midwives were to, if a child was born to a Hebrew woman who was a male, they were to kill them on the spot. And then there's this interesting story that happens there in the end of chapter 1. It's a story about two midwives for the Hebrew women that are there, Shiphrah and Puah. We don't know what the Pharaoh at that time's name was. We just know that he didn't know Joseph. But what we do know is the name of these two midwives. Isn't it interesting that God is using some interesting and different characters to carry out this covenant journey, this blessing journey with the people? They will live on in infamy because they feared God and were blessed because of choosing actually to disobey the Pharaoh. So what they did is they were slow in going. And when they helped the Hebrew women, they chose to basically tell a lie instead of killing the Hebrew boys. And so what they said was, the Hebrew women are so strong, they have the child before we get there. Well, just a little bit of a misleading truth to Pharaoh. When they're faced with an ethical dilemma or moral claims to not lie, and to not kill, they face the dilemma by choosing to not tell the absolute truth. I'm not advocating that we tell lies. I'm not advocating that we shouldn't be honest in all things. But I do know this. Sometimes we have to make choices and to choose what's better. Because of that, Moses was born. We set up for a deliverer. Our journey takes us back toward Canaan and the Promised Land. But hold on, it moves fast enough. For this moment, we want to spend some time in that moment that's happening when the Pharaoh is asking for the male children to be killed and the people and the characters that come in place. So here are the main characters in this story. The Pharaoh, the midwives who feared God, a Levite woman whose mother, Moses' mother. Notice with me, it's not Joseph's son. And so it doesn't carry on particularly from one particular chosen person out of the family to another. No, this was the son of Jacob and Leah. It was Levi. And Levi was the one who was designated as the priest. Moses' parents were Levites. And so we see the story expanding to a people. The other players, not only the Levite woman, Moses' mother, who held him away in fits to basket so it would float and so that Moses would be able to float around in the river, but Moses' sister and Pharaoh's daughter, unlikely. It's interesting that in these particular early scenes in Egypt, the Pharaohs are used to protect God's people even when they don't even know it. And so God is able to use them. The child Moses. It's interesting here that early on in the scriptures, the whole story is filled with heroes who were women, who saved the whole people and who helped live into the covenant. So Pharaoh decrees an order. The Levite woman hides a child. Pharaoh's daughter, who is swimming, sees him in a basket and pulls him in. A sister who's really keen and sharp, sees what's going on and sees the compassion in Pharaoh's daughter and says, "Don't you want me to get someone to come help care for him and nurse him while he's this young?" And she does and concedes. And so Moses' own mother becomes the one who nurtures him early on. Placed in that intentional area in the Nile, nursed by his own mother. And after weaning, becomes a child of Pharaoh's daughter. And so has the run of the house, so to speak, in Pharaoh's courts. It's the action of these faithful women that thwart the schemes of Pharaoh. In God's economy, I read this in one of the commentaries in the Wesley Study Bible. In God's economy, status and power are not the final brokers of history. God's mission is advanced through the faithful obedience of God's people. Let me say that again. In God's economy, status and power are not the final brokers of history. God's mission is advanced through the faithful obedience of God's people. My, how we need to hear that anew over and over. That it's not what we gain, it's not our influence, and it's not our power gained through financial status. It's that God works to those who are faithful, that God has a chance to work in. Interesting enough, in these first chapters of Exodus, God is not mentioned. We don't see the hand of God at work or doing this, but we know that God is in the midst of the journey through these characters. God's providence is seen in the midwives and in a determined mom, in a faithful sister, and a compassionate yet disobedient daughter. I read a book a while back written by Adam Hamilton entitled Moses. Adam's done a lot of work in different areas of the scripture and sharing those things. But here's what Adam said summarizes this whole early scene in Moses' life. It says this, and I quote, "To summarize, there's much we can learn from the story of Moses' early life. Don't give in to fear of the other as Pharaoh did. When those in authority call you to do what you know is wrong, resist them, as Shiprah and Puah did. When you face heartbreaking circumstances, trust that God is still at work, as Moses' mother did. And when you see those in need, let your heart be moved to compassion, as the Egyptian princess did. If you do these things, you may find yourself playing a pivotal role in God's saving story." Unquote. Well, what a wonderful message. How often do we let into our fears? What fear is driving you? I shared with you some stories about South Jackson, but to be perfectly honest with you, when the bishop appointed Sheila and I to South Jackson, I was scared. I mean, I'm a country boy who was in the county seat of Loosedale, Mississippi in George County. I loved the farm. I loved all of that sort of thing. And now you're putting me in the middle of South Jackson, a place that I'm unfamiliar with. And yet, even in the midst of my fears, I was able to find God's strength and presence, and to continue to move forward, beginning to welcome people and helping to make decisions, not out of fear, but out of how we can transform the community around us. What is it you struggle with? What is it that God's calling you to be faithful in and to stand against that you know is wrong? What is God calling you to? What heartbreaking circumstances are you going through? And can you trust God's provision? While I was in Ocean Springs and afterwards, I had a journey of being with a couple of parents, a couple sets of parents, who it was heartbreaking. In Ocean Springs, there have been several cases where children in their early years have an incredible cancerous disease called DIPG, diffuse intrinsic pontine glioma. I journeyed with David and Teresa Moeller as their daughter Sophia went through that. I journeyed with Angel and Josh Myers as their daughter Sophia later went through the same journey. And all I can say is, in the midst of that journey, the thing I saw the most in those parents and continue to see as I continue relationship with them is certainly the hurt and the pain of losing a child in that way. But the courage to trust that God was able to sustain them and that God will be with them. Do they still hurt? Absolutely. Do they still struggle? I'm certain. But is God there? They will affirm that with me, that God's presence has brought them through. And the way they have transformed the world by sharing this dreadful, awful disease and its ramifications, and by working toward research and by caring for others who may be going through the same thing, have been an incredible testimony and witness for us all to watch. So even in the midst of our heartbreaking circumstance, God can and will be with us to bring us through with provision. How is God at work in you? How is God wanting to use you today to help change the world and to transform it in His presence and in His love? Well, more of the story. After a long time, and after Moses was up and grown, he saw the hurt of his fellow people, the Israelites in Egypt. And even though he could have turned an eye to it and continued to live in Pharaoh's courts, he began to work to bring justice in the situation, which caused him to have to leave town for a while. And he wound up in Midian, there amongst the Midianites tending sheep. And it was in the midst of that that we see that. And Genesis chapter 2, verses 23 through 25, in the chapter saying this: after a long time, the king of Egypt died. The Israelites groaned under their slavery and cried out. Out of their slavery, their cry for help rose up to God. God heard their groaning, and God remembered His covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God looked upon the Israelites, and God took notice of them. I hope you join us next week to see how God continues to work in the midst of crazy situations. Well, may God be with you on your journey this week, and may you be filled and nourished. Again, I invite you to join me if you're able and if the weather permits in the park, so that we may share communion together, personally, looking in each other's eyes. It's hard sometimes, but even though we're wearing a mask and as we're social distance in those occasions, being able to look in each other's eyes brings a certain sense of peace and hope. And so I invite you to join me for those occasions. We do recall that on the night Jesus gave Himself up for us, He took bread, and He broke it and gave it to disciples and said, "Take and eat, this is My body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." When the supper was over, He took the cup and blessed it and gave it to them, said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is My blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me." It's because of these acts in Jesus Christ that we are united wherever we are in God's presence. May God's Holy Spirit come and fill us, unite us, and strengthen us for the journey. Bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. May you know God's provision and God's grace in the midst of your circumstance. And may you look for those who God is using to help bring about His love and grace to you. May you be blessed so that you can be a blessing to others. Go forth in peace. Amen.